Hello, you malt mannerists. Ralphie here at ralphie.com with whisky review 294, and a very special malty mention thank you to Tom in Oklahoma for that malt mention. Tom, your malt mention got malt mentioned, and that means that you have to pour yourself a glass of whiskey or bourbon. You're in Oklahoma, it's your choice, just whatever's handy. Promise me one thing, Tom, keep it quality. Keep it quality. It's not quantity, it's quality. And that doesn't just apply to whiskey, it applies to the enormity of our lives. Yeah. Back to whiskey. Caol Ila Moch, the first of three young Islay single malts that I'm reviewing. Because they're worth reviewing, they're not bad, but there's things you need to know. A little bit of background, a little bit of explanation as to what these malts are all about, whether it be Caol Ila Moch, whether it be Kilhoman, or whether it be Laphroaig Ciardas. It could be a young Beaumont, it could be a young Ardbeg. Alligator, for example. What we are seeing is the steady appearance of young single malts which do not carry an age statement. And there's a very simple reason, is that the whisky industry are a little bit squeamish about putting an age statement on a bottle of whisky that's below 10 years, because they believe that the punter, the customer, the consumer, as they like to refer to us, makes very rapid associations between age and quality. Now, this goes right back to blends in the 1920s, when Johnny Walker was sticking matured for 12 years, 12 years old on its label, when Isle of Skye was putting 8 years old or 12 years old on its label. What the blenders were saying to the customer is, we are charging a bit more for this blended scotch because we're using more mature, better quality stocks. Now, that was the message that the blenders were saying way back in the early days on their bottle. And it's that, that's a tradition that's really stuck, and it's been very prominent. In fact, it's utterly dominated the contemporary Scotch malt whisky scene. The distillers are trying to move away from it. Now, there's two reasons for this. Two big reasons is because they've got old stock which is a little bit flat. It's not quite top ranking stuff, but if they put some of the younger whisky in it, it'll taste fine once it's been successfully blended together. Naturally, with this old stuff that they're putting into their blend of malts, still a single malt because it all comes from the same distillery, they want to charge accordingly. So if, for example, they were to combine a cask of 14-year-old, off the top of my head, Macallan, for example, just an example, with 30-year-old Macallan, then they'd have to put an age statement in the bottle of 14 years old, whereas in fact it could be quite possible that the majority of malt in the mix is 30 years old. And because of that age statement, then they've got to bring the price down. That's the connection. And another reason is that with the steady but slightly overhyped, from my opinion, global demand for Scotch whisky, the distillers are saying to themselves, we've got to get our product to fulfill demand. We've got to get our product out on the shelves, more volume out on the shelves of shops, and we've got to do it now, because if we don't, our competitors will. And it's a perfectly understandable position to come from. It's business. They're simply looking after business. So what we're seeing is the appearance of younger versions of familiar single malts, from established distillers, right, like Caol Ila Moch, like Ochentosh and Valanch. Excellent young whiskey, by the way. Don't assume all young whiskies are not so good. They can be excellent. They can be, although some aren't. And you've also got the new start craft distilleries like Kilhoman, like Kilcairn from Glengyle Distillery, like Avingerick from the Isle of Lewis, where they need being small distilleries. The banks are not helpful. We all know how unhelpful the banks are. We all know what an extreme problem banks have become and will continue to be, because there is, of course, an agenda. But that's for another day. That's for another vlog. But they need to get their spirit out there sooner rather than later to get the turnover, to get the money in, so that they can buy new casks, so they can produce more spirit, and so they can grow. Starting off a distillery is hugely expensive. Once you're up and running and selling your stuff, then you can relax a little bit. Then the profits start kind of maturing. But that's I think enough of an introduction to young malts. I will be, as I'm reviewing the Kilhoman and the Laphroaig Ciardas, I'll be saying a little bit more about it. But we're going to pour ourselves some Caol Ila Moch, bottled at 40. Excuse me, where's my? It will be a minute. Here it is, 43%, and it says that Moch is the Gaelic word for dawn. Oh, lovely. It's like Ciardas. Ciardas and Laphroaig. What's it Gaelic for? Friendship. Lovely. You never see them using Peter or Poch Mahoy on their labels, and I doubt you ever will, which is another fine Gaelic word. I have to be honest with you, by the way. It pisses me off a little bit. The license that the distillers take with Gaelic. And it's a very simple reason. The suppression of the legal distillers in the 17th and 18th century in Scotland, an awful lot of that suppression was in the West Coast, where alcohol, the production of the alcohol, it wasn't just for drinking as we do now. It was currency. It was economic empowerment. It was self-respect. And the brutal, and it was really brutal, children got their limbs broken to deter their parents from distilling. That's been quite neatly written out, the romantic history that you get about Scotch whisky, but it was violent, it was cruel, and it was as vicious in many ways as the history of the production of rum, the rum industry. And in fact, it was after the successful illegalisation of Usquebaugh Bay production in the west coast of Scotland, apart from a few, very few licensed distillers, that so disempowered the Gaelic community that it allowed the landowners to start their ethnic cleansing and their clearances. If you're in America, if you're in Canada, if you're in Australia, if you're in New Zealand and you've got Scottish ancestors, you will understand what I'm talking about. Anyway, whiskey. It really has got quite an almost an absinthe arrival of on the nose, kind of sharp fruitiness. It's interesting and engaging. I reckon this is what, 7-8 year old ash, briny, salty, tar, road tar, vinegar, peat, vegetal, sappy, fresh wood, bitter wood, cardamom, celery. There's that vegetal note that you get from young Caol Ilas. Interestingly, if you buy young single malts, you'll notice little new make vegetal notes that, particularly in peated whiskey, that disappear by the time they've reached 10 or 12 years. That's what makes McClellan's Islay, which is Young Bowmore, so popular amongst the knowledgeable whisky enthusiasts. It is young Bowmore, and it's actually better than the entry-level official bottling of Bowmore. Cabbage, vanilla, touch of raw mezcal, pickled ginger, water livens up considerably and brings out a touch of English mustard. So a busy happening thing this, which of course you would expect because it's relatively heavily peated, and young peat can be very expressive. Taste. Oh, the sacrifices I make. A steady, prolonged arrival. Seaweed, briny, vegetal, celery, celeriac. Cabbage again, semi-sweet, salty. Salty as an old Pulteney. Solventy, carrots. There's a mineral note, really quite a strong, slightly chalky, granity note. And touch of yeast. Cough sweets, fennel, anise, overripe raspberries, overripe black currants when they're starting to go off. The finish, peaty, of course, swift, fish oil, cod liver oil to be specific, and rather rapid. Now that's the thing about young single malts. You've still got the dominance of the spirit, the new make spirit that's come out of the still. It hasn't had time, it hasn't that prolonged interaction that you need to get complexity and to build up the levels and layers in a good old single malt. But it is short, but it's decent enough. Now, what are we going to award this? Marks. It's not gin, it's not blend, it's malt. Where are you, my little Marks? Where's my Marks? Can't find my Marks. Excuse me. I thought I was all organised. Where the hell have I put them? Oh, there they are. They've fallen on the floor. Dress rehearsal? Nah. 82 out of 100. Now, if you've bought a young whiskey and you feel hangabout, I've paid good money for this. You know, there are times where a young whiskey can be more expensive than its older branded, and there's one reason the distillers do that. It's the novelty of an unaged new market whiskey. People will pay more for novelty, for something new, for something fresh that they've not seen before. And also, if it sells, then they can up the price on their standard bottles. Be aware of that. What you can do, two things, and this is what I'm going to conclude with this malt review. Two things you can do to tone down a frisky young single malt and to actually enhance the quality. First, the tone down. This ingredient, Canadian maple syrup. We don't have to worry about adding maple syrup to whiskey because it's wood sugars. And there's already wood sugars in whiskey anyway that come out of the cask it's been matured in. I had a wee straw here for popping the stuff in, and I don't know where it's gone. So I'm going to use the teaspoon. I would recommend about two or three drops, one, two, three, plenty, for a glass, and a full teaspoon for a bottle, particularly if it's peated whisky. Stirring, stirring, stirring. Initially, you will taste maple syrup and whisky. However, leave that with a cover on it for about half an hour and come back to it, and you'll be amazed at how it's integrated into the coarser young spirit and mellowed it, taking away the rough edges, particularly in the finish. It's something I've mentioned in the past, the use of maple syrup for dealing with bad whiskies, but you can also use it in conjunction with decent whiskies which just need a little bit of a lift. Another thing that will lift is using older, same malt. Now it's Caol Ila we're reviewing, so it's got to be Caol Ila to keep it a single malt. This is the 12-year-old unpeated. If I add a small drop to that glass and leave it for 15 minutes, it will significantly improve the quality of this young Caol Ila whilst retaining its youthfulness. Now, if you don't have it, can't afford a full bottle of older stuff, you could get hold of a miniature, or if you're in a whiskey club, you could arrange, if you come across a young whiskey that needs a bit of a boost, then you can club together and split a bottle between you. Simples. Lovely. There's no such things as problems, malt mates. There's only solutions. And the solution is, if you want to learn a little bit more about Kilhoman, the single sherry cask release 2012, or my opinions on the Macher Bay, or is it Macher Bay Moor or something? It's, you know what I mean. Pop back again for Whiskey Review 295, where I will be sharing opinions, because we love opinions. In fact, opinions can be so much more useful than facts at times. It's just the way of the world.